My name is Kate Skinner. I'm a physical therapist and I have hypermobility. I also specialize in chronic pain and complex conditions, including hypermobility. Today, I wanted to share with you a research article because, especially in the last couple of years, I've been really excited that there is more and more research being done on hypermobility and hypermobility conditions. And I think it is a great opportunity for me to be able to share some of that with you, for me to be able to explain what some of that actually means to you, and also the limitations in what research does, because sometimes I think it's easy to grab onto a tagline, but not actually fully understand all the information behind it. So I'm hoping that I am able to kind of help you with that fairly quickly. So today I want to talk about an article published in 2019 called The Relationship of Joint Hypermobility with Low Back Pain and Lumbar Spine Osteoarthritis. And this was done by Good, Cleveland, and Schwartz et al. And published in the BMC Musculoskeletal Disorders Journal, which is a peer-reviewed research journal. It's really important that you pay attention to where your information comes from, because peer-reviewed research journals means other professionals within the industry have reviewed the study, made sure that it's valid, made sure that it's worth producing compared to other areas and aspects online that people may not have credentials or may be conveying information that is kind of hearsay or tagline type things that can be misconstrued. So in this article, they were looking at hypermobility and chronic low back pain and osteoarthritis development in the low back to see if there was a link, because low back pain is such a problem around the world, and especially in the US. It is extremely common. It causes a lot of loss of work. It is an expensive problem that we here in the US are having to deal with. And oftentimes, outcomes are not great. And so low back pain by itself has been this huge thing that people have looked at research-wise. And this one really looks to see, does hypermobility increase your risk for chronic low back pain? Because that's something that we can address differently. Or osteoarthritis, which we know arthritis can contribute to back pain. So what these authors did is they analyzed three large studies, and each of the studies had 1,000 to 2,000 participants in it. And some previous studies that have been done have looked at small subgroups with hypermobility, and it's really hard to do a study. And if you only have 20 to 30 people and they're all young, they're all male, they're all EDS, while it's nice to be able to determine what issues they have, it's actually not as accurate and objective in terms of the population to figure out what things matter. So this group looked at previous studies that had been done that were looking at and did measure joint hypermobility via the Batten scale, and including the forward bending and chronic low back pain and osteoarthritis of the low back, which they measured using x-rays to look at facet arthritis, disc degeneration, and bone spurs. And then they put that into a statistical model to determine rates, whether people with hypermobility were at higher risk or not. And what they found is that hypermobility was actually not correlated with chronic low back pain or with lumbar osteoarthritis. And one of the things that they did find is the ability to bend forward and put your hands on the ground, which is called trunk flexion. Basically, that ability to forward bend made you less likely to have back arthritis or arthritis in that lumbar spine as compared to someone who couldn't do that. Now, what this study means to you is that really you might not be at higher risk for arthritis or for back pain as compared to the general population, which is great because across the board and so many of the things that I have seen and read, chronic back pain or spine pain is one of the symptoms that they look for with hypermobile disorders. And so having something that even says that maybe that's not as correlated is really a good thing for us who are hypermobile. It also means that having that flexibility as you age is a really good thing, and that continued flexibility onto later years may decrease your risk for problems or for back pain problems and improve your function. And so that is a positive that we can take away. Now, with studies, we always talk about limitations because there are always limitations to studies. It's never a perfect world. You can never control for all variables. And so it's a matter of understanding, you know, how many variables were they able to control for, and, you know, how much can we trust what it's saying. And there are a couple of things just to keep in mind with this study. One, while it did look at some larger groups of people, women of childbearing age were not represented, which is, you know, basically that women, you know, 20 to 50, one of the studies did not do back x-rays of any women in that age because of potential risk. Others were not as represented because of potential relationships between pregnancy and being of childbearing age. The other aspect is that minorities were very, very minimally associated in the studies that they looked at. There was only one study that actually had minorities in it. Most of them were white Caucasian, which obviously skews your results, and not everyone was as well represented. They also had quite a few older people of older age within the study, and we do know as people age, your joints do stiffen. And so someone who might have been hypermobile younger in life may no longer qualify for hypermobility. They found about 13% of the people in the study actually qualified for hypermobility, which was outlined at greater than 4 out of 9 for the Bain scale. So your take-home summary, the biggest thing is remember to take care of your back. And the things that we've talked about, including posture and strength and moving correctly, because with the hypermobility, you may not be at a higher risk for back osteoarthritis, but for sure the general population is at risk for back injuries. And so the more we can take care of ourselves, then the better we feel, the more functional we are. And while back osteoarthritis may not be an issue, it does not take into account SI dysfunction, sacroiliac joint, or other issues that can cause and contribute to back pain as well. So take home, we're not at higher risk for osteoarthritis per this particular study, which is a positive. But that doesn't mean that you can't still have back pain and back issues. So hope that helps. I look forward to bringing you other articles. If you come across an article that you think is really interesting or you feel like makes a strong statement to you, please forward that to me. I would love to see kind of what you're looking at, and also to be able to give you my take on the information as well.